works within the party, they call the Green Academy. That is actually an institution where budding politicians are actually groomed for some higher responsibilities. So I wouldn't say all this came as a surprise, but I must be honest with you that when eventually it did happen that I got nominated and went ahead to win the primaries, it immediately dawned on me that this is a huge responsibility, to the extent that I actually found myself asking, who said is this something I really want to do? I called up a few people within our Nigerian community. You is one of them, and by the way, he's been a friend and associate for quite a time. I also spoke with Harry, Madam here, and a few other people that are not here to say, listen, this is what has happened. I'm feeling the weight of the responsibility because, okay, when such confidence is reposed on an individual, you owe it as an obligation to at least do your very best to deliver. I recall that one single thread that ran through all the advice that I got from all the people that I spoke with, including the ones that I have named here, was this is not a journey you need to embark on alone. You can't do it alone. You have a community here, a Nigerian community, and let us find ways and means of reaching out and make this a collective project, so that ultimately, when we all carry the load together, it will be lighter. And so one of the ideas that flew out of that initial consultation was to identify when Nigerian community organizations meet and then personally come to, meet them and specifically seek your blessing and your support, of course, as our culture demands. Apart from organizations, of course, and talking to key individuals. So it was in that context that I was here last week to meet with the Edo Union, and I was also tour of the Edo Forum. And I cherish the opportunity to meet with you. Now, I won't go into the details of why and what I will be going to the European Parliament to do, but I will simply touch on the experience I've had being a councillor. This is my seventh year as councillor. I first contested election in 2006, won, and then became councillor exclusively for social affairs. That's what we call OCMW Rad League. And in that period, the only thing that I did was simply look at issues that border on poverty and how poverty could either be minimized or preferably eradicated. As you know, our people here in this country are in very weak social conditions. Not because they are not hardworking. As a matter of fact, we are known to be very, very hardworking, because once we pick up a job, we are known to work very hard to keep the job. But the problem is that the playing field is not level enough for us, that we are not able to even flow in at the level that we should. That was one of the first observations I made. The other one, of course, has to do with discrimination and all of that. And I found, talking to people up across Europe, because I was for some time the chairman of the Nigerian Diaspora Communication Europe, So that gave me the opportunity to meet up with Nigerians from at least 19 different European countries. So we interact on what works here and what doesn't work there. A specific example, some of us that trained as teachers in Nigeria before migrating to Europe can't even find a job as cleaners in schools where we were supposed to be teaching. That's a huge anomaly. Take medical doctors, you don't even find Nigerian medical doctors here, maybe one or two isolated cases. But those who manage, you know, to come here can't even find job, even as nurses, in hospitals where they are supposed to be working as doctors. To even work as a nurse here, so as somebody who had already qualified as medical doctor in Nigeria, you'll be required to go back to school for a minimum of 3 years. Meanwhile, in the UK, these things don't happen. You simply need to take a professional entry exam. If you pass that exam, which is the same one that British graduate medical students take, if you pass it, that's it. You are admitted into the medical services and you can begin to practice. So you see, the European Parliament occupies a very, very important role or position in this sort of disparity. So if it works in the UK, well, definitely it must work in other 26 countries of the European Union. But then, the political will by the national politicians should be there to make it happen voluntarily. But if they are unable or unwilling to do it voluntarily, that's where the European Parliament now steps in to say, well, it works here, we have to make it work in other places by standardizing the law and the practice. Take also the issues of trade between Europe and Africa. We believe, personally, and my party stands behind me on that, because before your nomination, you also have to talk about the issues that are of importance to you and the issues that you will be going to the Parliament to talk about. One of the issues I took to heart is that of Africa-Europe relations in terms of trade. The relationship as of today is built more or less on aid, giving us a handout. And that is not because we are not good business people. Yes, we are very good business people, but the trade arrangement between Africa and Europe is done in such a way that as of today, there is that culture of dependence. Things are woven in such a way that we will continue to rely on them. They don't pay the right prices for the products that come here, even the services. Some of them, the productions have moved to Africa, where they get the cheapest of labor. Okay? So all of those imbalances, they will begin to change. And I think when people hear me talk about this, I think the first thing is fear. Oh, what is this guy going to that parliament to do? So he's, just like we say in Nigeria, the guy won't come on carry for woman, So I tell him, I say, listen, that's not the point. Now, with the taxpayers' money, they provide aid to Africa. Now, we are saying that the relationship should be built not on aid, but on trade. Trade with us on fair ground, on fair level. The profit that accrues out of the fair business deals you make with us is enough to sustain us. So you keep your aid and let us survive on the basis of the fair business arrangement we have with you. Then you don't have to be answerable anymore to your taxpayers, because they scrutinize all of this. So you keep your money, your taxpayers, keep the money that they were supposed to be contributing and all of that. And then we break that yoke of dependence on Europe. Okay? So these are abstract, highly ideological issues. But you see, for a very long time, these issues have been, pushed to the side. Nobody is actually pushing them in the manner that they need to be pushed. And so the problems continue to linger. Now, I'm not telling you guys here that I have the magic wand to make things change overnight. But what I'm saying is that as long as the issues are not brought up and made a strong political issue for debate, for discussions, and begin to think of ways and means of changing them, our children will come to inherit those problems. And I don't think that that is what a responsible father or mother should be doing. At least we should be seen to have done our bit in our time. Sometimes the things we do, I look at it and I feel like, well, we are fighting a losing battle. We are first generation migrants here. We have our limitations with language. We have our limitations with adapting to their cultures and all of that. So all of that make a number of things difficult that you can even look and say, well, what is the point? The thing that will work, sir, just forget it. Yeah? But then, when you think of your role as a parent, as a father, or as a mother, who want to bequeath the right legacy, who want to prepare the soil better for the children so that when they plant, it will germinate, then you say to yourself, there is a reason to keep doing some of these things. Now, I'm saying this just to let you know that I'm not being naive or simplistic to say, don't worry, your problems are going to be sorted out tomorrow. No, it's a very, very long journey, but we've got to start it someday, because if we don't, you make a start and you move gently, you move gradually. If you don't start, you are not moving anywhere. And then your children will come and meet up the same problem. And at some point, I tell you, they're going to ask the question, wait a minute, daddy and mommy, what did they do all these years? I'm not sure that any of us want to be confronted with such questions. Now, all of us cannot be politicians or vie for political office at the same time. Some of us are willing and able to do that, but the rest of you are part of it, because a politician needs power to be able to accomplish the things he feels strongly about. And that's where you guys come in, because the power rests with you. You are the ones that send whoever goes out there to represent you. And that's where you come in terms of a strong appeal to each and every one of you to say, this is what I am all about. I need your support to get there, because this is not about Collins Nweke. This is about us, about a community. And let me not forget the host community as well. I'm not going to the parliament, to the European Parliament, to fight only the battles as they concern the ethnic minorities or the Nigerians. No. It is something that will benefit all of us, like my records in Ostend has shown. I'm not a counselor only for Africans or Nigerians. Issues that I take on are issues that, concern everyone. I'll give one example. One, very, strong positive files that I defended recently have to do with handicapped people. It also has to do with elderly people, okay? The fact that they don't have access to certain public services. To be honest with you, I don't know any single Nigerian that is a handicap in Ostend. Neither is there any of them that is so old that is working with a walking stick. No, so that is, an issue that concerns everybody. Another very important example is in the city council, job vacation students, to be able to get a job as a vacation student, you have to either be the son or the daughter of a councillor or a staff of the city administration. Now, check the employment records and you will find that perhaps less than 1% of the people working there are non-Belgians. And even at that, they are not even getting any fair chance of introducing their children to be able to get a vacation job there. So I uncovered it and I said, no, this is wrong. And I am ready, capable and willing to go to court to seek the right for the vacation job to be left open for everybody. Let my children